This is the day the Lord has made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it because we have a choice to rejoice. Isn't that wonderful? You have a choice to rejoice. Glory. We are in a season of victory. We are in a season of a new beginning. Do you know, it's pretty powerful because most people don't even realize that, and I really believe that we have entered Jubilee, not exit. One of the things that's occurred, because you can tell by the fruits of what's going on. Jubilee is associated with 50 years. It's 49 years plus 150 years. And in Jubilee, all debt was removed. All debt was canceled. Land was restored to people. All kinds of things happened in the year of Jubilee. And every 50 years, the Israelites would have to forgive debts, return land, and so forth. And I really believe that we've entered the year of Jubilee. And the reason for that is because Israel became a nation in 1948. But what was restored to Israel was Jerusalem in 1967. Does everybody get that? Wow. And I really believe because 1967 and 50 equals what? Amen. So we got to remember that because Jerusalem was restored to Israel, 50 years from that date is another year of Jubilee. And I believe that, you know, many people have been proclaiming that we've gone into Jubilee and we've come out of it. No, I really believe that we're entering Jubilee now. Now we're entering it. This is the year 2017 of Jubilee. Because if Israel was restored if Jerusalem was restored to the Israelites, that was a time of Jubilee. Does everybody get it? Now, there's something else that's happening also. Because one of the things is Israel stands in an identity associated with God. The Jews and the Israelites stand in an identity associated with God as creator. And one of the beautiful things is that when you become born again, you are grafted into the same lineage as identified, associated with God, the creator. One of the things that beginning to happen is so many people, and it's amazing to me because the Holy Spirit just won't let me go on this. He says, my people don't know who they are. And so easily to give up their identity. So easily. One of the things that, you don't choose your identity, you accept it. Does everybody got it? Everyone say, I don't choose my identity. I accept it. See, what happens is we're searching. Many are still trying to search for their identity and trying to find out who they are. And we know that the ruler of this world is Satan. And he doesn't want you to know who you are. Because when you do, he's afraid of you. Oh, glory. Even Esau sold his birthright, which is associated with his identity, for worldliness, for food, for carnal substance. And so many people are so easily selling their identity and birthright, which is associated with their identity, for substance of the world, for sin of the world, for the pleasures of the world. In Ephesians chapter 1, accepting your identity, oh glory. One of the things you can read about your identity, the Word of God will tell you who you are. But you will never experience your identity until you're in the presence of God. Does everybody got it? Your identity is identified with God's presence. That's why so many people don't really get who they are. They lose it. Why? Because the enemy keeps people away from the presence of God. Even though they read their Bible tells them who they are, but they're not experiencing their identity because it's only experienced in the presence of God. Glory to the Lamb. Ephesians chapter 1 and verse 3. Would you read it with me? Blessed be the God and the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with every spiritual blessing in heavenly places in Christ. Just as he what? He chose us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before him in love. Having what? Predestined us to the adoption as sons and daughters by Jesus Christ to himself according to the good pleasure of his will. In other words, he chose me and you to be his sons and daughters. To be his son and daughter means you have an identity of him. Jesus, that's why he said, I am. And the devil said, I will be, I will do, I'll be like him. Does everybody get it? I will be like the Most High. I will ascend. I will. That's what the devil says, I will. God says, I am. And this is where you become, when you find out your identity, you are I am because he is. Verse 6. Let's read verse 5 again. Having predestined us to adoption as sons and daughters by Jesus Christ to himself, according to the good pleasure of his will. So was it his will? Was it his desire? Yes. To the praise of the glory of his grace, by which he what? He made us what? Accepted in the beloved. In other words, you accept your identity. You don't choose it. Does everybody get this? Because many people are trying to choose their identity of worldliness. Well, I'm going to be this. They're associating their identity with things of the world. Now, don't get me wrong. There is a worldly identity. But there's an eternal identity that supersedes every identity that the world can try and place on you. Is everybody okay? It says in verse 7, in him we have what? Redemption through his blood. The forgiveness of sins according to the riches of his grace, which he made me to abound toward us in all wisdom and prudence, having made known to us the what? Mystery. The what? The mystery of his will. See, when you truly know who you are, you know his will. You know his will. Now, his will isn't going to be played out in an arena. He's going to give you a whole plan of what to do. You know that his will is seek, ask, find, trust, rest, wait. Amen? Remember, God never interrupts himself. So his will is always to discern that there is never an interruption. Any voice that interrupts God's will is not God. Amen? Oh, having made known to us the mystery of his will, according to his good purpose, which he purposed in himself, that in the dispensation of the fullness of the times, he might gather together all and all one, all things to, in Christ, both which are where? In heaven, which is the unseen, and which are on earth, which is the seen, in him. In him also we have obtained a what? An inheritance. How many of y'all know that an identity also is associated with an inheritance? In him also we've obtained an inheritance, being predestined according to the purpose of him who works all things according to the counsel of his will, that we who first trusted in Christ should be to the praise of his glory. Wow. You and I are adopted as sons and daughters, offsprings of the creator of all things. Again, your identity is reflected by birth. Amen? It's reflected by birth, by inheritance, by environment, by associations, by conduct, and by citizenship. I'll repeat that. Your identity is reflected by birth, inheritance, environment, associations, conduct, and citizenship. These are six reflections of identity. Six meaning man. This is according to your identity. These are things, reflections of who you are. Does everybody get this? In Ephesians chapter 2, in verse 1, it says, "And you he made alive who were what? Dead in trespasses and sins, in which you once walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit who now works in the sons of disobedience." That was our identity. We were sons and daughters of disobedience, known as children of wrath, among whom also we all once conducted ourselves in the what? Lusts of our flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and were by nature children of wrath, just as the others. In other words, you and I were born in darkness. We were rebellious. We had a rebellious nature. We were searching for identity. But we already carried an identity that when we didn't even know we were already expressing. Children of wrath and rebellious. We were testing all identities to see if this is the one who we are. Not even knowing that we were testing them. Only not able to understand. There was no understanding of the identity. The fight to find true identity and accept and maintain and express an identity. Again, you can't express what you don't have. You express what you do have. That's why the word says you'll know them by their fruits. They're expressing their identity. Does everybody get it? Again, in this world, we are identified by our name, our number or social security number, and citizenship, and gender. Again, we are identified by our name, our social security number, our citizenship and gender in the world system. That's what the world system identifies you as. The Babylonian system that rules this earth. Again, in the world system, you're identified by a name, a social security number, your gender, amen, and your citizenship. That's what identifies you. In the world system, also in the social systems, we are identified by degrees, you know, education, talents, experiences, and so forth, especially in the job industry. There's a special identity that people have in the job industry. Degrees, talents, education, and experiences of the in the job industry. We are identified by social arena, by music. Influenced by music. We are identified by sports. Food. Somebody will identify you by what sports you like. What music you like. Does everybody get this? What foods you like. Your clothing. Your dress. What's attracted to you? Your friends, your hangouts, Many people are identified by their past. What's been labeled on you, addiction, thief, liar, prisoner, whatever, criminal person, whatever, or job titles. We've been identified by job titles, employment positions, and we've been identified by our successes and failures. Accepting what the world places on us is an identity, what we call fiction or false. Because it's related to the world system in hope that you never find your true identity. So the world system will try to place an identity. Let me tell you, demonic forces try to place an identity on you. In hope that you never find your true identity and accept a false temporary identity stamped by darkness. Satan wants to stamp you with his identity. In Romans 6, that's what the media tries to do. The media tries, the world system media tries to set an identity, stamp an identity on someone that is incorrect or false. Romans chapter 6. Is everybody okay? In verse 1, Romans 6, 1, accepting your identity. What shall we say then? Shall we continue in what? Sin that grace may abound? Certainly not. How shall we who died to sin live any longer in it? Or do you not know that as many of us as were baptized in Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? Everyone said, I died in Christ and rose in Christ. That's what relates to my new identity. Actually, I'm just being restored to who I was before I became here. Amen? Verse 4. Therefore, we were buried with him through baptism into death, that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in newness of life. You can't walk in a newness of life without knowing who you are. For if we've been united together in the likeness of his death, certainly we shall also be in the likeness of his resurrection, knowing this, that our what? Old man, the one you were born with, was crucified with him. Unless you choose to accept a false identity that has been labeled upon you by darkness. That the body of sin might be done away with, that we should no longer be slaves of sin. Because your old identity, the old man, is a slave to sin. For he who has died has been freed from sin. Woohoo! You know, Jesus gave you the formula, what? Deny yourself. So there's three levels of death. Death, more death, and greater death. Hallelujah. Verse 8. Now if we died with Christ, we believe that we shall also live with him, knowing that Christ, having been raised from the dead, dies no more. Death no longer has dominion over him. For the death that he died to sin once for all. But the life that he lives to God. And that should be me and you. The process of death, of course, is to die to the old ways, the old nature, the old desires, all things of influence and strength in the old man. Death is constant. Actually, what you're doing is you're walking away because you've died in Christ. You're walking away from death into life. Why? Because the wages of sin is what? death. So since you've died to sin, you're walking away from that death, and you're walking in life constantly. But every morning you wake up, you know who's there? The old man. You sleep with that dude. You awake with him. You walk with him. When you get in the mirror, first thing you see is him. Snap. So you begin to, so there's that fight already of identification. There's that fight of identity. As soon as you go in the mirror and you start washing your face, putting your makeup on and all the other stuff, trying to cover that dude. Guys are shaving, combing their hair, trying to dress up the old dude. So one of the things that's going to have to happen, we got to keep dying. So when we look in the mirror, we say, no, that's not you. I'm just using a body. I'm just using a body. Same thing, a body was prepared for me before I came. Same thing that Jesus, a body was prepared for him before he came. Although his was made of the word, yours and I is made of dust. So that means you and I have a body of flesh, which is the old man, the old nature that loves sin. So you got to constantly turn around and slap them. Now that does not mean person. It means identity and character. In Luke chapter 9. Accepting your identity. There is a tremendous battle in identity. There's a fight immediately. As soon as you wake up, there's a fight for identity. Immediately. That's why, to maintain your identity, you first must cut loose of yourself. You must disconnect from the old before you can connect to the new. And you disconnect by what you say. Good morning, Holy Spirit! You're connecting, but you're first disconnecting. Why? You know when you ignore something, you begin to disconnect it. You're waking, you sleep, you awake, everything you do is always behind you. But when you wake up in the morning, he's before you. Every day is a new day. You wake up in the morning and there he is. You better call on the Holy Spirit so he can get behind you. Even Jesus said that to Peter. He said, Satan, get behind me. Amen. In Luke chapter 9, see, so many people don't realize and they struggle because they don't disconnect before they connect. Praise God. Look what Jesus said. I love this. In verse 60, then Jesus said to them, let the what? Dead bury their own dead, but you go and preach the kingdom of God. Praise be to God. And another also said, Lord, I will follow you, but let me first go and bid them farewell who are at my house. Jesus said to them, no one having put his hand to the plow and looking back is fit for the kingdom of God. Why? He wanted to go back, didn't he? Oh, glory. Go to Genesis 19. So you must constantly disconnect your past, which is identified with your old man. Now, Lot lived in a place called Sodom and Gomorrah. And Sodom and Gomorrah was in an area which we call was wretched, perverse, evil. There was nothing but perversion. There was no respect of human mankind. and people were raped, people were molested, children, there was homosexual, lesbian, all kinds of things, all kinds of genders. And the angels came to rescue Lot and his family because God was getting ready to destroy this place. He said, enough is enough. And then in verse 18, and Lot said to the angels, please know, my lords, indeed now your servant has found favor in your sight, and you have increased your mercy, which you have shown me by saving my life. But I cannot escape to the mountains, lest some evil overtake me and I die. See now, this city near enough to flee, and it is a little one. Please let me escape there. Is it not a little one? And my soul shall live. And he said to him, see, I have favored you concerning this thing also, and that I will not overthrow the city for which you have spoken. Hurry, escape there, for I cannot do anything until you arrive there. Now, I want you to understand that God will not bring his wrath until we arrive home. Therefore, the name of this city is called Zoar. And the sun has risen upon the earth when Lot entered Zoar. And the Lord rained brimstone and fire on Sodom and Gomorrah from the Lord out of the heavens. So he overthrew these cities, all the plain, all the inhabitants of the cities, and what grew on the ground. But his wife did what? Looked back behind him, and she became a what? A pillar of what? A pillar of salt. And see, so many people, want that is a representation of a hardened heart, because your connection to your past will always keep you hardened. It'll always keep you hardened. You are no longer connected to your past. You are connected to your future. This is associated with the days of Noah, the days of Lot. Yeah, look at, what were they doing? They were choosing their gender. Do you know that? It's amazing now that in some countries, children at the age of 5 can choose their gender. In this country also. But that's turning around. At the age of 5, children can go to school and choose what they want to be. Even though they were born a male or female, they are allowing them to say, do you want to stay a man or do you want to stay a woman? That person ought to be shot. At the age of 5. You talk about perversion. You talk about sick. All these things are going to change because the Antichrist has been removed from office. That spirit that is perverse and evil and wicked and promotes ungodliness has been removed from the office of this country, and things are turning around. So that there's a lot of things that are going to begin to happen. In fact, I don't know if you know or not, but it's the first time in history that a high-ranking officer in the government, our vice president, went to a pro-life? March for Life event. The first time ever. Amen. Ever. I'm telling you things that, why? Because this is Jubilee. Things are being turned around. It's the same thing when Jesus went into the temple and kicked over the tables. He's kicking over the tables and throwing everybody out. Amen? It's happening. Praise God. So these children, talk about being confused. So remember, your identity is not chosen. It's what? Accepted. So what they're doing is they're telling these children, choosing an identity. That's incredible to me. Those people ought to be fired. The Holy Spirit unveils your true identity, wiping away the old by cooperation. In Galatians chapter 5. Accepting your identity. That's why we don't go around the room and meetings and whatever and say, hi, my name is such and such and I'm an addict, because that maintains an identity of addiction. Amen? But it's good to keep your same identity as a gender. Hello? You really don't, you must accept that. That's not your choice. It was God's choice. You don't flip a coin and say, I'm going to be a boy today and a girl tomorrow. Hallelujah. Galatians 5. Is everybody there? Verse 1. Let's speak it together. Stand fast, therefore, in the freedom or liberty by which Christ has made us free, and do not be what? Entangled, engaged, again with the yoke of what? Bondage. Indeed, I, Paul, say to you that if you become circumcised, Christ will profit you nothing. In other words, if you go back to that tradition, because how many of y'all know that traditions are associated with people's identity? Your cultures. I always say it all the time, man. I'm no longer Italian. My blood runs in the throne room of God. I'm Christ. He who is in Christ is Christ. It don't matter what country you came from, it doesn't matter. You know, it was amazing. I was doing a teaching in a class in a jail, and this one guy could not get this arena. And when I was showing about all kinds of stuff about relationship and salvation and whatever, and he said, but I'm Catholic. I said, no, you're Christian. He says, no, I'm Catholic. See, he was identifying himself with an organization. And that's what the enemy wants you to do. So he identifies you being Catholic, Protestant, Baptist, whatever it is. We're not associated with those things. God's not looking at your identity of being associated with an organization. He's looking at your identity being connected to him. And this guy just couldn't get it. I said, you're a Christian. He says, no. He says, I'm a Catholic. I said, you're Christ-like, aren't you? No, I'm Catholic. No identity. He said, well, my girlfriend is a good Catholic. I said, does she sleep with you? Yes. I said, well, she don't know God then. Because he kept saying, she knows God. I said, if she knew God, she wouldn't be having sex with you. Hello? See, false identity, isn't it? He was quiet the rest of the time. Didn't raise his hand and ask a question at all. So here, many people want to go back to traditions. And this is what Paul was saying. Look at man, if you become circumcised, Christ has profited you nothing. It's got nothing to do with it. And I testify again to every man who becomes circumcised that he is a debtor to keep the law. You have become what? Estranged from Christ. You attempt to be justified by law. You have fallen from grace or God's plan. For we through the Spirit eagerly wait for the hope of righteousness by faith. For in Christ Jesus, neither circumcision nor uncircumcision avails anything but faith working through love. You ran well. Who hindered you from what? Obeying the truth. This persuasion doesn't come from him who calls you. What does that say? A little leaven leavens the what? Whole lump. That's all it takes is one agreement to begin to spread. One false agreement. One voice that you agree with to begin to spread. And believe me, you're already exchanging your identity for your true one for a false one. 2 Peter chapter 2. So you got to understand that the fight is over your identity. That's how things begin. The enemy comes to steal your identity. It's always see. Don't relate your identity to any of your sicknesses. Do not relate your identity to your past of successes or failures. Your identity is not to be entangled in this world at all. Amen. Now you may be a doctor, a nurse, a pastor, whatever. That's what people the world identifies you at, but that's not your identity. Your first identity is Christ. I am because he is. 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 20, I believe. Would you read it with me? For if after they have escaped the pollutions of the world through the knowledge of the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, they again entangled in them and overcome them. The latter end is worse for them than the what? Why? Because their identity has been exchanged, lost, and they picked up a false identity. And believe me, when the enemy gets you to do that, he comes to kill. He no longer comes to steal. He comes to kill and destroy. He knows that you've come close. You've already accepted it once. You accepted who you are. Now he wants to come when you've exchanged your identity by associating with your past or things of sin or ungodliness, even things of agreement or approval. He knows you've opened the door to him. Now he knows that since you've touched it and tasted it once, he's going to come to wipe you out. Oh, hallelujah. Verse 21, for it would have been better for them not to have known the way of righteousness than having known it, to turn from the holy commandment delivered to them. But it happened to them, according to the true proverb, that a dog, and the word dog means demonized person, returns to his own vomit, a soul having washed to a wailing in the mire. But thank God for his mercies and grace. Amen. That you and I can come back. But man cannot rescue you. Only God can. When you get in that condition, only God can rescue you, and man can't. 2 Timothy 2. That's where Paul said, better to turn them over to Satan that their soul can be saved. Why? Because they're going to eat a lot of dirt and hope to call out to God. Glory to God. 2 Timothy chapter 2 and verse 1. Let's speak it together. Is everybody there? Everybody okay? Amen. You know, this is so profound. I mean, it is the foundation. This is a part of your foundation is your identity. It is your foundation. Your foundation is in Christ. Amen. It's in the Holy Spirit. But man, when you begin to lose who you really are, when you begin to identify yourself of your talents and abilities or office instead of Christ, you've already drifted from it. You know, people associate, oh, aren't you the son of... Remember how they tried to associate Jesus? When Jesus wasn't preaching and healed and in the synagogue and whatever, and they said, wait a minute, this guy, what he's saying is different. He said, Isn't he the carpenter's son? Isn't he a carpenter, a son of Mary and Joseph? They didn't identify him as the Christ. They were identifying him according to his abilities and talents and culture and family. And people will do that with you in the world. But you must maintain your identity. You don't choose it, you accept it. In verse 1, let's speak it. You therefore, my sons and daughters, be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus. And the things that you have heard from me among many witnesses, commit these to faithful men and women who will be able to teach others also. And you therefore what? Endure hardship as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. No one what? Engaged in warfare entangles himself with the affairs of this life. In other words, you no longer identify yourself with this life. No matter what you do, the world will identify you according to this world of what things you do. Oh, he's a truck driver. He's this. He does. He's a carpenter. But that's not who your identity is. Does everybody get that? No one engaged in warfare entangles himself in the affairs of this life. Oh, so you're a mother. Oh, you're a father. Oh, you're their son. You're their daughter. No. That's how the world identifies. But my identity is Christ. Does everybody get it? My identity is Christ. And it must stay that way. And you can't allow, because when you begin to accept certain things of the enemy, he begins to steal your true identity. He likes to creep in any way he can because he likes to promote, first of all, because pride goes before a fall. Pride opens doors. He wants to promote your carnal identity. If he can begin to promote your carnal identity, does everybody get it? Your worldly identity, he can steal your true identity. Again, no one engaged in warfare entangles himself with the affairs of this life, that he may please him who enlisted him as a what? As a soldier. Entanglements. We don't want to be entangled in these things. 1 Corinthians chapter 5. In verse 7. Oh, let's start at verse 4. It says, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, when you were gathered together along with my spirit, with the power of our Lord Jesus Christ, deliver such a one to who? Satan, for the destruction of the flesh, that his spirit may be saved in the day of the Lord Jesus. Your glorying is not good. Do you not know that a little leaven leavens the what? Whole lump. Therefore, do what? Purge out the old leaven. Cut loose. Disconnect from the old man. That you may be a new lump, since you truly are unleavened. For indeed, Christ, our Passover, was sacrificed for us. Purge out. Cut loose. Disconnect from. The word leaven means sin. In Galatians chapter 4. Now let's go to Galatians 2 first. Galatians 2. Galatians chapter 2. Hallelujah. Everybody there? In verse 1. Then after 14 years, I went up again to Jerusalem with Barnabas, and I also took Titus with me. And I went by revelation and communicated to them the gospel which I preached among the Gentiles, but privately to those who were of reputation. They're privately to what? Those who are of reputation, because they had an identity. But Paul was bringing them their true identity. But see, they wouldn't be amongst the others because they saw themselves above others. Lest by any means I might run or had run in vain. Yet now even Titus, who was with me, being Greek, was compelled to be what? Circumcised. Well, listen to this. And this occurred because of false what? Brethren, secretly brought in, who came in by stealth, to spy out our freedom or liberty, which we have in Christ Jesus, that they might bring us into bondage. This is what the enemy does. To whom we did not yield submission even for an hour, that the truth of the gospel might continue with you. But from those who seem to be something, whatever they were, it makes no difference to me. God shows personal favoritism to no man. For those who seem to be something added nothing to me. So in other words, he wasn't going to let anyone's identity influence him. Glory. I love it. But there are those who creep in and try to steal your identity because they don't have theirs. Galatians 4, in verse 1. I said that the heir, read it with me, as long as he is a child, does not differ at all from a slave, though he is his master's of all, but is under guardians and stewards until a time appointed by the father. Even so, we, when we were children, were in bondage under that what? Elements of the world, false identities. But when the fullness of the time had come, God sent forth his son, born of a woman, born under the law, to redeem those who were under the law, that we might receive the adoption of sons. Isn't it wild? Because everybody was labeled under the law, God said, I'm coming to fulfill the law, that you are no longer labeled and have your identity according to the law, but you have your identity in me, no longer a slave to free to sin or to the bondages of elements according to the world and traditions of men, but you are free in me. In verse 6, and because you are sons, God has sent forth the Spirit of His Son into our hearts, crying out, Abba, Father. Therefore, you are no longer a slave, but a son. And if a son, then an heir of God through Christ. But then indeed, when you did not know God, you served those which by nature are not God's. But now after you have known God, or rather are known by God, how is it that you turn again to the weak and beggarly elements to which you desire again to be what? In bondage. This is the ploy of the enemy. He slips in so easily. Oh, hallelujah. Elements of the world. Again, you don't choose your identity. You accept your identity that was predestined for you by the great I am. Amen? Go to Philippians 3. Philippians chapter 3 and verse 17. Let's speak it. Brethren, join in following my example. Note those who walk as you have us for a pattern. For many walk, of whom I have told you often, and now tell you even weeping, that they are enemies of the cross of Christ, whose end is destruction, whose God is their belly, and whose glory is their shame, who set their mind on earthly things. For our citizenship is where? In heaven. This is what we identify ourselves. We identify ourselves a future. We live from the future to the present. Our citizenship is eternal, not here. For our citizenship is in heaven, from which we also eagerly wait for the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, who will transform our lowly body, that it may be conformed to His glorious body, according to the working by which He is able even to subdue all things to Himself. Where is our citizenship? Heaven. Romans 8. Now you will run across people that you used to know from your past. And they will only know you according to your past. They'll try to identify you. The enemy will use them to try and influence you to accept your past. The word says, I'm a new creation in Christ. Old things have passed away. All things become new. I'm no longer accepting my past anymore. I've been cut loose from my past. I only use my past now for the testimony of the power of Jesus Christ. Nothing to promote myself. Because if you promote self, you promote the old man. And you've just given his identity back. And he's going to wipe you out again. Romans 8:12. Is everybody there? Let's speak it. Therefore, brethren, we are what? Debtors, not to the flesh, to live according to the flesh. For if you live according to the flesh, you will die. But if the Spirit you put to death the deeds of the flesh, you will live. What's the flesh? The old man. The old identity. For as many as are led by the Spirit of God, these are sons and daughters of God. But you got to be led by the Spirit of God. For you did not receive the spirit of bondage again to fear, but you received the spirit of adoption by whom we cry out, Abba, Father. The Spirit Himself bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God, and if children, then heirs and heirs of God, and joint heirs with Christ, if indeed we suffer with Him, that we may also be glorified together. I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be what? Revealed in us. Look at that fight is constant. That fight is constant. Remember, your old man is trying to take your identity and promote his. Romans 6. Verse 12. But you first must recognize that there is a fight for identity. Amen. That's the purpose. Is your identity according to the way the labels are placed on your life? That's why we cut labels off. Verse 12, let's speak it together. Therefore, do not let sin reign in your mortal body, that you should obey it in its lusts. And do not present your members as instruments of unrighteousness to sin, but present yourselves to God as being alive from the dead, and your members are instruments of righteousness to God. For sin shall not have dominion over you, for you are not under the law, but under grace. What then? Shall we sin because we are not under the law, but under grace? Certainly not. Do you not know that to whom you present yourselves slaves to obey, you are the one slaves whom you obey, whether of sin leading to death or of obedience leading to what? Righteousness. But God be thanked that though you were slaves of sin, yet you obeyed from the heart. From where? The heart. That's a desire. That from that form of doctrine to which you were delivered. And having been set free from sin, you became slaves of righteousness. Oh, hallelujah. Newness of life. Go to chapter 7. Newness of life. Let's speak it. For when we were in the flesh, the sinful passions which were aroused by the law were at work in our members to bear fruit to death. But now we have been delivered from the law, having died to what we were held by, so that we should serve in the newness of the Spirit and not in the oldness of the letter. Everything is being made new. Ephesians 4. Accepting your identity. Then you want to maintain it. Ephesians chapter 4. Hallelujah. Verse 20. Everybody there? Let's speak it. But you have not learned Christ, if indeed you have heard him and have been taught by him, as the truth is in Jesus, that you put off concerning your former conduct the old man which grows corrupt according to the deceitful lust, and be renewed in the spirit of your mind. Now listen, when he's talking about your old conduct, your old man, that is your old identity. And that you put on the what? The new man, which was created according to God in true righteousness and holiness. So you are accepting your identity. You're maintaining. You are fighting to maintain your identity. That fight is constant. It's not only pressed outward, but the fight is inward with the old man, because the old man is battling you every day. So you must be led by the Spirit so you can keep him crucified. But you first wake up and disconnect so you can connect. In verse 1. Now the word says something powerful. It says, as a man thinks, so he is. As a man thinks, so he is. So the enemy tries to speak to you. He tries to put everything in your path. Look at what education does to people. Education equips people to serve in this realm. Does everybody got it? It gives them an identity to serve in this realm. But there's an education that comes from above that allows me and you to live in this realm, but not be servants taken by darkness to serve darkness, but we serve light so that we can rescue people from this realm and bring them to the, connect them to the knowledge from above that they can use the things of this realm to infiltrate the world system. Not that this system uses you. Oh, hallelujah. So in this, as a man thinks, so he is. As a man thinks, so he is. So thoughts are very influencing. What you hear is influencing. Music will turn your identity like this. What you read will turn your identity like this. What you associate with. Why? Because as a man thinks or as a man hears is what he becomes. You're either going to place the old man and feed that old man with the things of the world, where it's going to constantly overtake the new man because it's identity in what it's hearing. And as a man thinks, so he is. Now listen, if your belief system is flawed, if what you're hearing is flawed, if it's against God, it's called flawed. Amen? Then your perception is that way too. Your perception is flawed also. You cannot perceive the things that are pleasing to God. Why? Because your belief system is going to associate with your identity. Well, this is what I believe. It's going to create an identity in me because I'm accept all the things that I'm believing, I'm accepting. So I'm partaking of what I'm believing, and that's going to create an identity in me. Has everybody got this? So I'm constantly severing myself from all entanglements and affairs of the world, especially emotional attachments, music. Anything that will promote the world has got to be removed. Amen? Why? Because it's going to put an identity on you of the world. Oh, hallelujah. Verse 1, let's speak it. If then you were raised with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ is, sitting at the right hand of God. So again, when things are happening in your life, what are you seeking? So a struggle comes. Something happens. Do you go to him first? This is why? Because what are you doing? You're going to the source of your identity. He is your source of identity. If you're going to everything else first, then you're exchanging your identity. That's why how many times people get upset, they go eat. Because their identity is flawed. Their belief system is flawed. Oh, man, I can't take it. I better go eat. Or people go use drugs. Because their identity is not established. Does everybody get this? Oh, when I get nervous and stuff, I go do this. Well, you wouldn't go doing that if your true identity was solid. You would go to him and connect. Lord, you're my source. You're my identity. I trust you. I cast my cares upon you, for you care for me. I commit to you my works. I acknowledge you in all of my ways. What are you speaking? You're speaking eternal words. That's what? Promoting your identity. So you're reestablishing your identity when the enemy tries to steal it. Because he's going to come and try and steal it. We're all being warned today. Hallelujah. Set your mind on the things above, not on the things of the earth. Verse 3, for you died and your life is hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is our life, appears, then you also will appear with him, where? In glory. Therefore, put to death your what? Your members, which are on the earth. Fornication, uncleanness, passion, evil desire, and covetousness, which is idolatry. Because of these things, the wrath of God is coming on the sons of disobedience, in which you yourselves once walked when you lived in them. But now you yourselves are to put off all these: anger, wrath, malice, blasphemy, filthy language out of your mouth. And do not lie to one another, since you have put off the old identity with his deeds and put on the new identity, who is renewed in the what? Knowledge. Everyone say knowledge. That's why God says my people are destroyed for lack of knowledge, because lack of knowledge is preventing an individual from having their true identity. It's amazing to me how many people call themselves believers and don't read the Word of God. Why? Because you can't have your identity. But again, the Word of God tells you who you are. The presence of God expresses who you are. And have put on a new man who is renewed in the knowledge according to the image of him who created him. Where there is neither Greek nor Jew, circumcised nor uncircumcised, barbarian, Scythian, slave nor free, but Christ is all and in all. Therefore, as the elect of God, holy and beloved, put on what? Tender mercies, kindness, humility, meekness, long-suffering, bearing with one another and forgiving one another. If anyone has a complaint against another, even as Christ forgave you, so you also must do. But above all these things, put on love, which is the bond of perfection. And let the peace of God rule in your hearts, to which also you were called in one body to be thankful. Let the word of God dwell in you richly, in all wisdom, teaching and admonishing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing with grace in your hearts to the Lord. And whatever you do in word, do, or deed, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God for the Father through him. Accepting your identity. Predestined. Set before you. Remember, the devil comes to steal, kill, and destroy. When you truly know who you are, you connect to who you are. But the enemy comes to tempt you to exchange your true identity. Beware. The devil comes in many forms. Amen? He's seeking whom he may devour. And the first thing he will do is take your identity. Then he accesses you and places you with another. Praise God. Father, we give you all glory and honor. We thank you for your word. We apply the blood of Jesus upon the seed that you've imparted. We ask that you prepare us in communion. And Lord, we just want to say thank you. We are just in awe of what you're doing, what you're showing us through our spiritual and physical. Again, Father, let your kingdom come and your will be done as we prepare for communion in Jesus' name. Everybody said amen.